Good day, guys. Austin here. And in this one today, welcome to the future. Welcome to the future of gaming. Imagine a world where we have no limits, where we're not tied to a platform, a console, a publisher, a brand, or hardware, able to play every game from the start of interactive media known today as gaming up to today's modern AAA titles. A discrete piece of hardware able to be placed in your front room, not just tied to gaming, but also able to play movies, TV shows, music, and the internet all from your couch, any controller of your choice. I bring to you the ultimate gaming system, able to play games from almost any gaming system. Atari 2600, NES, Super Nintendo, Sega consoles, Nintendo consoles, Sony consoles, old computer games, modern consoles such as the Xbox, Wii U, PS3, etc, etc. The latest games such as PUBG, Fortnite, Battlefield 5, and almost everything in between. Choose whatever game you want to play from an interactive menu layout or manage from an operating system as soon as the system is booted and easily updated once new games arrive. This has been tackled time and time again on YouTube with people building PCs, but you will find time and time again they don't consider all the games, they don't consider the normal person. And they often cost you into the thousands of dollars to replicate, just focusing on modern gaming. Imagine if I said we can play anything from any console or PC, and this could be done all at the same price of a modern gaming console, around 300 of the finest UK pounds. I am not selling these. I am showing you what can be done with easy to find parts and a bit of thinking outside the box. I'm not a PC fanboy. I'm not a console fanboy. I am a gaming fanboy, and for over 35 plus years I have been gaming, and I have been collecting and playing all the consoles I can get my hands on. Building and playing PCs and making the most of all the best games the world has ever known. I still love and still think the original consoles are the best way to play many of these old titles. But just like my music and my movie collection, I want to be able to enjoy them hassle-free on hardware that is just plug and play in one location. One controller on a tiny modern piece of hardware. Sure, we can use things like the mini NES consoles, Raspberry Pis, etc, etc. But these are often just tied to one system or very low powered, meaning you can only play old games, meaning again you need multiple systems set up in order to play them all. Let's build a small, cheap system that does everything. Let's build the ultimate gaming system. As we talked about, we want to use this as a console, not as a PC. So we need an environment that allows us to use everything on the PC with our controller. Choose games, choose media, browse websites, etc, etc, using our controller with an instinctive GUI. There are many options for this, free, paid, and available in many shapes, sizes, and tastes. I have chosen Launchbox for this setup, as for me it's the most user-friendly and easy to set up, the most customizable to get to whatever taste you want. Able to launch almost any game that has been invented up to the latest titles available today, including PC games, emulated, media, music, anything you wish. All set out in a great, easy-to-use interface that can be used with a controller. With complete bios, metadata, game art, etc, etc for almost every game that has ever been released in history and updated almost daily. This can be done so the system boots straight into the GUI, transforming the PC into an easy to use controller based console that can play almost any game from any system from any time period. Now I do have to warn you that the version that you're seeing on the screen right now is the paid version. It costs $20 full price. which means that, yeah, this is more cost on top. But there are other GUIs front ends similar to this, which are completely free, and also Launchbox does have a free version. I do also have to say that I have zero affiliation with Launchbox whatsoever, or in fact any other front ends, and there are plenty out there that are free to use. However, I did get in touch with Launchbox and the lead developer, which is Jason, and he has been awesome. He said that he is going to offer a discount or a giveaway or something along those lines for probably a limited time period for anybody who watches this video, which is absolutely awesome. So once that becomes available, I'll put information in the description down below to sort you guys out. Again, I'm not getting any kickbacks, no cut from any of this whatsoever. So again, there is more information on my channel for other front ends if you wish to go in a different direction. I'm just trying to give you guys options. Also, I have to say, it's probably common sense, but no games or anything like that is included with this front end. It's merely just a launcher, a GUI, like a menu system, obviously looking all fancy and simplifying the process of launching games, organizing them, putting them into a nice little front end as you can see now. I just have to put that out there in case you think that you install this and you get all these games for free or something. That's not how this works. Again, more information about all this kind of stuff in depth is all over my channel. I've been doing this for years.
Hey guys.
Peter, are you all right?
You know what? I feel good. I feel like I want to giggle behind my hand at a lot of things and hold but not eat a big ice cream cone.
So let's get into the good stuff, the benchmarks. Let's see how this puppy is performing with our games. Now, I focused on two different types of games, one being emulated games and one being PC games. If you're building something like this, you're more than likely going to play everything that you've got at your disposal. Now, during these tests, obviously I can't test everything on every system, on every emulator, but what I can do is play the more taxing games and, of course, the more taxing emulators. I can also play the most popular ones, and they're the ones that I've tried to show throughout these tests. So first off, we're going to focus on the PC games, but be aware that all the way through this, I have tried to keep it, well, I have kept everything at 1080p, and also I've tried to keep all graphical settings to maximum wherever possible to maintain at least 60 frames per second, as long as the game supports that kind of stuff. Of course, with games which are more twitchy based, more reaction and more competitive, I've tried to push the frame rate wherever possible. But bear that in mind that we are playing this on a budget system. So let's see what this can do. First off, we've got Counter-Strike Go, and this one performed as expected, to be honest. It is a twitchy kind of game, so I wanted maximum frame rate, and we all know Counter-Strike can be played pretty much on your dad's laptop. This is not exactly a system hog, but I did want high frames per second, so I turned everything onto maximum, and to be honest, whatever thrown at this, whatever game type, whatever map, it always seemed to maintain at least 100 frames per second, which, to be honest, when I'm playing this game, is what I would want, and it performed like a dream, as you can see. Next up, over to Overwatch. Now, to be honest, this is the first time I've actually played this game. I bought this game just so I could test it for you guys. I've heard that it's popular, and I know why it is popular. It never suited my kind of gameplay before, but from actually playing it, it's pretty damn good. It was a lot better than I expected, but enough of that anyway. In terms of performance-wise, yeah, 70 to 80 frames per second most of the time. If things got really heated in battle, it would drop to around maybe high 50s, but most of the time never dropping below 60 frames per second. This is on high settings. Of course, if you wanted to get this even more twitchy, then you could drop some settings to make sure that it was a constant, I don't know, 80 frames per second, no problem whatsoever. I didn't see any stutters, no glitches, no nothing like that. This is a pretty damn stable game and highly enjoyable along with it. Next up, I wanted to try some driving games to see how this impacted the machine, and to be honest, it was pretty damn good. Pretty damn good indeed. These are the settings that I used for Wreckfest, a pretty new game that has been released not so long back. It's very much physics based, and there is a hell of a lot of vehicles on the track at the same time, so I thought this might bring it to its knees. I knocked it back to medium settings. I pushed some of the settings up on other parts, as you can see, but to be honest, I could have ramped this up even even further. I was getting pretty high frame rates. It was stutter free. The system wasn't taxed too much, but I was obviously maxing out my GPU. I was getting pretty much solid 70 to 100 frames per second, depending on what kind of area the map I was on, depending on what was going on the screen at the time. But visually, it looks absolutely stunning, and playability wise, it was perfect. So you guys asked me to test out Project Cars, and here it is. I've not played this for some time, but it's still looking absolutely beautiful. Now, I'm playing this on medium preset, obviously 1080p like we talked about. I could have gone for better visuals and probably impacted on the frame rate, or I could have gone for a better frame rate and impacted on the visuals. The medium preset seems to be a pretty medium middle ground for all this kind of stuff, and it performed like a dream. I was getting well over 60 frames per second, often into the hundreds. It was obviously taxing my GPU, but of course, depending on what I wanted to knock back and what I wanted to push up, I could have pushed this whichever direction I want. I would say it was very, very playable. There was zero stutters. The frame rate was nigh on perfect, and it was overall a great experience from a great game. On to the number one most requested game for me to test on this machine, Fortnite. Everybody plays it. It's not really my tipple, but I don't know enough about it to actually judge it on. But this isn't a review. This is to see how well this is performing. Put it in the comments down below as well, guys, if you're willing to show me the ropes on this game, because I do want to get into it. It's just one of those games that I'd rather play with friends rather than, you know, just going onto a public server. But anyway, we digress. In terms of performance, I put everything onto high. I didn't need no tweaking, and it played like a dream. Anywhere between 60 to 100 frames per second. No glitches, no slowdown, no lag. It played perfect. I probably could have done more tweaking, and again, the joy of PC gaming, I could have either got better visuals, or I could have ramped it down and got better frame rate. But to be honest, it was a good sweet spot for this one. It's not the most demanding of games, but it does get pretty intensive when things start going crazy. But in terms of performance, it blasted out the doors. So this game I wanted to test because I'm going to be testing out the PlayStation 3 version in just a second, obviously emulating it. So I want to have some kind of comparison to go on to. Now, this is the Dark Souls franchise. In particular, this is Dark Souls Remastered on Steam. This isn't very well for configuring, to be honest. It plays pretty damn well, 60 frames per second, no problem whatsoever. There are some areas where it goes into the 50s, but I think that's me recording at the same time as me actually playing the game. When I was playing this normally, I got a solid 60. Now, there isn't any settings that I can mess around with from what I can see. I'm no pro when it comes to this game, but at the end of the day, who is? It's a beast of a game. But I did want to show some footage of it working so I can draw on some comparisons in a second when we start doing the PlayStation 3 emulation. So, Dark Souls Remastered, no problem. So now I wanted to test some more, I don't know, graphically intensive games. Games that would bring this system to its knees. Now, first off, PUBG is probably the biggest hindrance of them all. It's mostly down to optimization from the actual game itself rather than my system, but I did want to show it because it is a popular game and I myself like to play this one. When I was playing this on the normal map, such as the, I don't know, I can't even remember the call, the desert map and the normal old map, it was fine. 60 frames and above, no problem, pretty much all the way through. But on the gameplay that you can see now, this is worst case scenario. I've got medium settings on this one, but I have turned a few things into low just to get the solid 60 on the normal maps. But when I loaded up this one, Sandhawk, I think it is, the new map, especially when it's raining, it was going sub 60. It was very playable, and of course, if I knocked this all the way down to low, I probably would see well into the 60s and above. But I wanted to show you worst case scenario, and here it is. Very much playable as long as you're willing to make the sacrifices and turn everything on to low. Another game which is a bitch to play is Doom. This one is pretty system intensive. I mean, this game was released in 2016, I believe, but even to this day, it looks beautiful, and if you've got a dated rig, it can, well, hold it hostage visually. The great thing is, if you've got a modern GPU that can take advantage of Vulkan, it plays like an absolute dream. Luckily, our little build is utilizing a new Pascal card, and it takes full advantage of that. The gameplay you're seeing now is on medium to low settings, games, but we are seeing a very stable, very good frame rates. If we was to ramp this up a little bit further in terms of visuals, then we could probably see pretty, again, stable frame rates and see even better visuals. In terms of gameplay, there is no stutters whatsoever. It is maxing out the graphics card as expected, but we have got a lot of headroom that we could probably tinker with this one. So great game, great performance on this rig, and yeah, I enjoyed this one. And now on to the biggest beast of them all. This is the last PC game we're looking at before we get stuck into the emulation side of things, but by God, what a game. The Witcher 3, and to be honest, it plays a lot better than what I was expecting on this system. We've got the settings down to medium. Now, it still looks absolutely beautiful. We've got 1080p, but the difference between this game and all the others is this one loves CPU. It's a huge open world game, massive environments, a lot of stuff going on in the screen, a lot of things happening behind the scenes which to make it perform the way that it does, which means that it not only taxes your GPU to the maximum, in most scenarios it brings your CPU to the maximum also. So having this run to this kind of level on these kind of settings, I wasn't expecting it. It's likely down to the latest patches, both in terms of the drivers for the GPU and the game itself. But considering the last time I tested this on a similar rig, it plays beautifully. The only thing that I've had to turn down is the hair works are off and the textures are down to minimum, or should I say low. Other than that, everything else is on medium, so having the utmost in graphics is what you want from this. It's not a multiplayer game, which means that many a time you don't need the maximum frames per second, but I was getting in the high 40s in graphically intensive towns during combat and all that kind of stuff, but most of the time a solid 60. Sometimes in combat, in normal situations, it would go to the mid 50s. I see no stutters whatsoever as long as the HUR works are off and the textures are kept to minimum. It's just too much for that GPU. If you have got a stronger GPU, especially if you've got more memory on there, then you will see better performance. But for us, with this setup right now, it plays like a dream and it looks like a dream. Awesome game, and what a way to finish the PC section.
Pac-Man just gives me this feeling of giddiness, like there's all these tingles running up and down my nipples, and it's just this wonderful thing, like, hey, look, it's Pac-Man!
Onto the emulation side of all this, and this is the whole reason probably why we put this system together. Yep, PC games are awesome, but we want to play pretty much every game that we can ever play on this system. It's the whole point of us putting it together. So being able to play pretty much every retro system that you could imagine, from Atari, pretty much every Nintendo system, from NES, Super Nintendo, 3DS, normal DS, onto the Wii U, playing Zelda Breath of the Wild, of course. We're going to see how far we can push this. Moving on to PlayStation systems, PS1, PS2, even the PlayStation 3, and of course, pretty much every other system in between, especially Sega, my love. Now, as of yet, the Nintendo Switch is being emulated, but not to the kind of level where we would actually call it playable. Also, PlayStation 4 development is underway, so we can obviously emulate PlayStation 4, but again, nowhere near to any kind of standard where you would actually see games being played for any kind of enjoyment. It's more proof of concept at this time. So we're going to go through pretty much all the more intensive emulators, one that proved the compatibility with this build, and we're going to see how well it performs. We want the Zelda, we want the Persona 5s, we want every game that we have at our catalog being able to play on one system. It's the whole point of us making this. So let's go through these emulators, let's go through these systems and see what this puppy can do. So like I said, this system has been made to play everything that is retro. If there's an older system and it's compatible on an emulator, you can get this up and running no problem. So I wanted to start somewhere which would be demanding. And for me, PlayStation 2 is quite demanding even to this day. Yep, on moderate systems, you can get pretty much every game working bootable and playable, but to pump it up to some kind of enhancements where it would be fun to play on a modern system, I wanted to start with the more troublesome games, so I'm talking about Metal Gear Solid 2. The opening sequence, when you come in with the rain, the emotion engine taking its action, it does cripple most people's systems and really pumps down the frame rate, especially at 1080p. This system lapped it up. It was no problem whatsoever. It looks beautiful, it plays beautiful, and it was a really good experience. Then we can move on to games such as Gran Turismo series. Again, very demanding title, and it looks absolutely awesome when pumped up to 1080p with post-processing in action. Moving on to Shadow of Colossus, again, this one is the biggest hog for this system. An awesome game that had a remake for the PlayStation 4, but the old title still looks beautiful, especially when given the treatment that this emulator can give. It's an awesome game and it plays like a dream. You can get all the games working no problem again on normal systems, but I wanted to showcase what can be done when you've got a system that is capable of pushing this all the way up to 1080p and still giving a constant frame rate and stable playability. Onto the Nintendo Wii, and this emulator, Dolphin, not only plays Wii games, but it also plays GameCube games. I wanted to concentrate on the actual Wii stuff because this is the most demanding when played through it, but I would say that not only does this play all the games, you can push this easily to 1080p on this kind of rig, but also if you wanted to, you could push it even further, get 4K out of this if you're into that kind of thing. It not only plays them like I said, but it completely transformed them into making it look like it's a modern day game. Nintendo have never been into cutting edge technology in terms of the hardware, and playing them through something like this where you can actually enhance the resolution, it looks absolutely gobsmacking. The Wii was a standard definition console, and playing it on the original console, the games look a bit dated. Playing them through something like this, 1080p, modern controls, of course, if you wanted to, you can even use nunchucks, that's how enhanced this emulator is. It just completely transforms the games and makes them look like, well, they deserve at the end of the day. Let's take a look at the Nintendo 3DS. Now, in the past, this needed an absolute beast to run. Compatibility was low and the performance was terry bad. Nowadays, in the last 6 months or so, you can see not just games working, but playing on mediocre PCs. With this kind of build, you'll see them running not just at 1080p, but you can even blow the doors off and take it to 4K. Now, you may say, why run things at stupid resolutions? Well, the original console run at 250p. Now, that's alright, of course, on a little tiny screen, but when you're playing this on a TV, it looks a bit pixelated and a bit of a mess. So enhancing these games to be able to run on a desktop and with all its glory in full 4K, if you wanted to, specifications, they look beautiful and it does them true justice. Now, the compatibility in the past, as we talked about, wasn't the greatest, but the enhancements that they've brought in, the development that they've pumped into it, you will see the majority of the catalog now playable. Now, the way that the Citra emulator deals with the dual screen configuration is up to you. You can either split the screen into a large main screen and a small little one, and you can equalize it so they've both got both screens running in tandem. It depends on the game, depends on your preferences, depends on how you want to play it. Of course, the Nintendo 3DS had touchscreen. You can use either your mouse, or I believe if you use a PS4 pad with the touchpad controls, you can use that as the actual touchscreen on the emulator. It really does enhance the way you play it and still gets all the bells and the whistles that the original handheld console had. Now, some of these games look absolutely beautiful, blown up into these kind of resolutions. You've got all the features that goes along with this, including online multiplayer for all your favorite games. Now, in terms of the games, yes, you can play Pokemon. I'm fed up saying you can play Pokemon on this. The only game at the time of me recording this is Pokemon X and Y. They are non-compatible. There's a crash in there that they're working on. Hopefully soon they'll get that ironed out. But other than that, all Pokemon titles are playable. All the Zelda titles, all the Mario games, you're all good to go on this one. The catalogue for the 3DS is absolutely huge, and like I said, the majority of the games that are on that system are playable on this system. Enhanced, like we talked about, it's an absolute dream of a console, and it plays even better when you're playing them on the big screen. And now we get to the creme de la creme, the absolute limit of emulation. I'm talking about systems which are only just breaking through into the emulation scene. Now, these are pretty crippling emulators, and normally you need a very high-end rig to play them. We have, as we talked about, configured the build of this system in order for us to get the maximum out of emulation and of course PC gaming while still keeping to a budget. We are on the fringe of what this system can do. So emulating games such as this on systems such as this, we're pushing it, we really are. So let's have a look at some of these tests. As you can see, Wii U is playing like a dream. It is beautiful emulation. Any title that I've been throwing at this is pretty stable, pretty good to go. If anything, it's more of the emulator holding it back rather than the system itself. Now, all the titles that I've done are getting pretty solid frame rates. I'm playing all these titles at 1080p. Now, I could knock them back and get even more stable frame rates, running at 720p maybe, as the original console did in most cases, but we are emulating this, and you know me, I like to push things to the limit, so 1080p was the minimum. Now, Mario Kart, Xenoblade Chronicle X, Donkey Kong, Tropical Freeze, all those titles all run perfect. The only time when I ever got to any kind of difficulties was, of course, Zelda Breath of the Wild. It is running, it is playable, and if I knock it down to 720, it is pretty stable in its frame rate. But at 1080p, it's just not there. Unfortunately, it's getting in the mid-20s to 30 frames per second. Of course, this is a 30 frames per second game on the Wii U. And yeah, it is playable, it is completable. Of course, the more you play, the better it gets, but it's, for me, a masterpiece of a game, and it does deserve a good, solid frame rate. Don't worry though, we are going to be upping the specifications in the next video, but for now, Zelda Breath of the Wild just isn't quite there. It's playable, it's doable, but again, it's just not for me on this one. All the rest of the titles play like a dream, like I said. So in terms of the Wii U, you will get pretty much every game that is compatible with the emulator playing on this system, no issues whatsoever. It's just a shame that it just isn't quite there for Zelda Breath of the Wild. But don't worry too much, because again, like I said, I will be making another build and I will be choosing a CPU which will be more suited to this emulator. I have learned from doing all these tests and the way that it's reacting with these emulators is that it just needs even more CPU gruntage, in other words clock speeds, or it needs more cores. Now, I have sourced another chip out and I'm waiting for it to arrive, and I will update you guys as to a new build. It's in the same price category, so don't worry, we're not just adding more money to this to solve the problem, we're actually tinkering the system itself to try and find something that is best suited to all games. And that's what I wanted to achieve from this. I wanted to have a good starting base for us to work from, what we could develop on, learn from, and actually tinker to get everything working on the minimum budget possible. So yeah, Wii U, it is playable, it is there, but that one game, the one bloody game, is just not there. So on to the next. And the next one is RPC S3. That's the emulator, and we are emulating indeed the PlayStation 3. What a good day it is too. Now, I've got to say before we start getting stuck into this, this is very much a work in progress emulator. It was released a couple of years ago, it was more proof of concept at that point, but it has come on leaps and bounds in the past 12 months, I would say, up to the state where we're at now, where many of the titles are playable and completable and very much enjoyable. There is still a long way to go for compatibility and optimizations to get the most out of this emulator to work on most people's systems. This is a very powerful system in terms of emulation, so you will need a beefy rig to run this. Now, we've done our best on our budget to give us the best possible chance in order for us to get most of these games working. If it's a very compatible game with this emulator, 9 times out of 10 you will get it running on this system. The issues where you come to go is where you get the problematic games or the very graphically intensive games. So from my tests, unfortunately, Persona 5, it boots, it goes in games, it is fully completable, but you will get skipped frames and low frame rates. It's still some way to go. So optimization wise, it's not quite there for this system. However, if you've got a more beefier CPU, you can smash this and enjoy the games in all their full glory. I've also got to say that many of the IPs available on this system still aren't playable. So at the time of me recording this, The Last of Us, Red Dead Redemption, Uncharted series, and some others, they just aren't playable. Yep, they get in game, yeah, they are proof of concept, you can have a mess around with them, but they're just too glitchy, too low a frame rate, and crashes galore. But many of the other titles that are on there are very much playable. As you can see, it's a beautiful system full of wonders within its catalogue. The problem is, like I said, that this emulator is still early days. So even though we've given it our best shot, still not quite there. But I would say that this emulator is developing daily, and new breakthroughs are coming through daily. So as the optimizations increase, the system requirements will lower, and eventually we should see this in full bloom on this system. But like I said, when we're taking a look at the SEMU emulator, it's just a case of me doing all this trial and error and seeing what the best combination of hardware is to get the most out of our budget, bang for buck, playing all these games. Also, I've got to say thanks to all the emulators that I've covered whilst doing this video. I did so much footage, covered so many emulators on so many systems, it was just overwhelming. But to keep this even a reasonable length, which to be honest, it's not at this moment in time, I had to cut so many out. But if you guys want me to feature more systems in the future when we're doing our next build, let me know. I want to know what kind of systems you want to run. I want to know what you think are the problematic games for me to test to put all these systems through the paces. I want to hear those problematic games, those problematic emulators, those systems that you really want to get working. And I'll do my utmost to see if we can tinker and get this both hardware and software working in unison, where we can all game together on our favorite games of all time in one place. So on to the main gump for this, and that is the hardware. So for this build, I wanted to go for the most powerful parts possible, while still keeping within the budget of around £300. For me, that is a reasonable price to pay for a console, so we're not pricing ourselves out of the market. The issue is, for that price, we'd be lucky to get just a CPU and a motherboard. So with that in mind, I've opted to go for the used market. Do not worry, I am not using any hard to find specialist or underpriced parts to make up this build. Everything I've used is easily found on popular websites world round on most parts. I actually overpaid to keep the pricing of parts of this realistic. But depending on your country, the used market may vary. Obviously, for £300, even on the used market, we're not going to get blistering technology, but I've made this PC built for purpose to be able to play all PC games and at an enjoyable level. Also, to be able to emulate as many games as possible, including even the most modern emulators. I want to keep the build as low powered, silent and compact as possible to make this a valid option for front room use, not just for gaming, but for also movies, TV and music streaming. Everything we would expect from a modern gaming console. As all the parts used in this system are the smallest possible, you can go for almost any case you wish. Meaning, if you want to go for modern stylish case, or most low profile discreet case, cheapest or most expensive, new or used, the choice is all yours. Meaning that even though the parts may be used, it still look brand new and completely bespoke to your taste. If you do have more money at your disposal, obviously you can upgrade certain parts to give you even more power to your games. Or if you want to save money, you can source larger, more available parts for the same specifications. The actual parts then. CPU. At the core of the system, I've chosen the Sandy Bridge Intel i5-2500 CPU. This is now a very old CPU releasing in 2011. It runs off the 1155 motherboard socket, which means if you wanted to, you could also upgrade to the Ivy Bridge, giving us room for upgrade if needed. But for the purpose of this build, on our budget, the i5-2500 should do us just fine in most cases. Although this card now is 7 years old, in terms of performance, it still whacks a hell of a punch. For 4 cores working at 3.3 GHz standard and 3.7 turbo, even compared to modern CPUs, this thing packs quite the punch. The reason I chosen this CPU is bang for buck. At the time of me recording this, the price for this CPU has fallen rapidly, meaning you can pick one of these puppies up for as little as £35 or as low as £20 if you shop around. They are not hard to find. Memory and RAM. The Achilles heel and the reason this CPU drop is likely due to the memory bus. It's only compatible with 1333 DDR RAM. Although by today's standard this is very low, it will not affect you as much as some tech channels may have you think. Memory bandwidth is only an issue when you're running high-end GPUs, onboard graphics or APUs like the new Ryzen chips. Ryzen APUs use the onboard RAM as its graphics RAM, meaning that this is to compensate for what is normally DDR5 RAM found on modern dedicated GPU cards. It has to be blisteringly fast to keep up with these GPUs or the graphics will bottleneck, leading to terribly bad performance using slow RAM. For high-end GPUs such as today's Nvidia's 1070s and 1080s, low RAM will bottleneck the CPU, in turn not allowing the GPU to work to its utmost potential, meaning for CPU intensive games you end up with only a fraction of usage from your GPU, thus nerfing your GPU's capabilities, which is more than likely one of the most expensive parts in your build. Although this sounds extreme, in most cases it's only a 1-5% frame per second loss. But it's still not ideal if you're buying enthusiast grade GPUs, as it's just a waste of money. The minimum amount of RAM I would use to enable us to play all these games is 8GB, and that's what I've gone for. DDR3 running 33MHz can easily be found online for $30 at this grade. The GPU then, normally the bread and butter of the PC gaming side of it all. On mid to low end GPUs you won't see these kind of bottlenecks, as in most cases the required memory bandwidth is so low. So with our 1333MHz RAM, we have a realistic option of an Nvidia 1050 to 1060 before we start to see any of these bottlenecks in most games. To keep the price, the size and the power consumption low in this build, I've opted for the Nvidia 1050. But again, you can upgrade depending on your budget and what parts you can find in your price range. A new 1050 is currently about £120 at the time of me making this video. Secondhand, you can pick these up for £90. The one I've got is a Palette GeForce GTX 1050 Storm X 2GB edition. a well-known brand in the UK. But ensure when purchasing you do not buy one of the unbranded Chinese knockoffs. These are not as stated on their advertisements and are often BIOS flash lesser power cards used to fool your system. We could have gone for an AMD card, but for compatibility's sake, I would keep to Nvidia. Some emulators do not play well with AMD, mostly due to the way it handles OpenGL. As OpenGL is a widely used API in emulation, I tend to stay with Nvidia for compatibility's sake, but again, the choice is all yours. Onto the motherboard then, the spine of all this. It doesn't matter what motherboard you use for this build, I wanted to keep it as small as possible, so I opted for the Micro ITX version. As we are using a non-overclockable CPU, we don't need anything to an enthusiast level, keeping the price very low. The only requirement is an 1155 socket motherboard, and it has to have a PCIe slot for the GPU. These are very common and can be easily found for $40 or lower. I would, however, try to find one with USB 3.0 support for when you start adding hard drives, media, and all that kind of stuff. I managed to find a motherboard with 3.0, Bluetooth 4.0, Wi-Fi, plus 8GB of Geel 1333MHz RAM, and an i5-3210 for $80. This motherboard is a Gigabyte H77N Wi-Fi Revision 1, if that makes any difference, and is perfect for whole media setup. Also, handy hint, try to get either a CPU or motherboard that includes a stock Intel cooler or better. These are often included, as buying one used will cost you more in postage than what it's actually worth secondhand. Hard drives and storage then, it makes zero difference what hard drives you use on this as long as they are SATA supported. I would try to buy a bigger hard drive as possible to give you as much space as possible for your games. Modern titles do take up quite a bit of space, and once you start emulating you'll find how much these games take up. For this build, I opted with a 1TB standard hard drive. These can be found as little as £20 online. Plus, even come with a year's warranty if you buy from CEX or something similar. I'm not sure if this is available in other countries, but I'm sure you have the same equivalent in most regions. As a bonus, in with the price, I also opted for a 250GB SSD. This is not essential, but it kills me to boot a machine that runs its operating system from a normal standard hard drive. It's just not as responsive. With 250GB, you have enough space for the OS, a few programs, and even some for your favourite games for a snappier experience. Of course, non-essential, like I said, so if you miss out on this, you can still have extra cash to upgrade your CPU or GPU if wanted. These can be found for days at about $40. Now I know, it's not best practice to use secondhand drives due to failure rates, but in all honesty, in my 30 years of making and using PCs, I've only ever had 3 hard drives fail on me. And my PCs are on literally for like 24/7. Maybe I'm lucky, you judge, but as long as you don't store your family photos, etc. on there, and you buy from a site that offers some kind of warranty or protection, you should be good to go, at least for a year in the worst case. Now for the boring bit, the power supply. Again, you don't require anything special with the PSU, and they can be picked up for pennies. I would, however, go for known branded PSUs, and if possible, one that has an 80 bronze certificate. It may sound silly spending so much on a power unit, but cheap ones will often fail or not be up to the standards that they actually advertise. I would, however, opt for a 550W or over PSU, as although complete overkill for this build, it will give you headroom if you want to upgrade or wish to use it again in other future builds. I budgeted $30 for this, but if I was you, I would spend an extra $10 and buy a brand new one or a well-branded one for the sake of mind. Onto the case then, the bit that makes it look all flashy. This is all down to your personal taste and budget. As almost everything we use is small form factor, you can use almost any case. Remember, you need to have one that fits the PCI Express or the graphics card and the power supply you have chosen. Unless you want something super small, you should have no worries. I managed to pick up the Thermatate Core V1 Mini for $20 on my local ads, and this was in almost perfect condition. These are tiny, and in the future we're going to go even smaller for the same price. Now, ignore the all-in-one cooler I have in there at the moment. This is definitely not needed in this setup. It will not affect your build in any way by including it. We have non-overclocked CPU in there with lots of ventilation, so something like this is complete overkill for this specification of build. As I talked about, this is not the end of these build videos. I want to do some experiments with some other CPUs in this build in the coming weeks. I added the water cooler in there as I would have had to take apart almost the entire PC for me to add the cooler later down the line. So I did the sensible thing and added it now. That way I can showcase some more options for you in future videos. But for you guys, just stick to the stock cooler. So in total then, so far we have gone for the i5-2500, that is £35. 8GB of 1333 MHz RAM, $30. 1050 NVIDIA GPU, $90. The PSU was $30. The hard drive, $20. 1155 motherboard compatible is $40. And the case was $20. Meaning that the total price for us to get running bare bones is £265. However, again, you can add the optional SSD in there for $40 to give you a much snappier experience. Bring the total up to £305, which I believe is around about $390. But that comes in for quite the bang for buck. And in just a second, I'll show you exactly the performance that we're going to get from modern PC gaming and some of the most demanding emulators available today. Remember that although this looks quite expensive for the total US price, I know that much of those parts can be found for a fraction of the price over there.
Who are you?
We are the Knights Who Say...
No, not the Knights Who Say...
The same!
Well, what is it you want?
We want... a shrubbery! Or else you will never pass through this wood... alive!
So we've built the system, we've put it all together, and we've tested more or less everything that I can throw at this. And what have we learned from it? Yeah, we can more or less play everything or every system that can be played on a PC. Emulated PC games, this will play everything. The only time it stumbles is on those modern advanced emulators on the cutting edge games. So yeah, they are more than playable, but for me, it's not the complete gaming experience. So we do need to push this even further. Again, like I've said over and over in this video, I don't want to throw more money at this. What I want to do is tailor the actual specifications to suit these emulators in particular. So, building more PCs. Let's build another one and see where that goes. This time round, again, I want to keep the budget in the same bracket. But, I've just ordered a new case. This is it. It's basically the same size as a PS4. I'm gonna get more grunt and more specs out of this one while still keeping on the same budget. I'm just waiting for the CPU to come through and we are good to go. I cannot wait to get my teeth stuck into this and see what we can smash out of this build. I love building these PCs. I love testing emulators. I love games in general. So doing things like this for me is just bread and butter. I could do this all day. The only thing is I want to hear from you guys is what systems would you like me to test? Obviously, I'm going to push those more troublesome games to see if those work on this build. But I want to know if there's any systems you want me to showcase in particular. Sega Saturn, Dreamcast, some of the more retro systems. If there's any features within those emulators or in fact PC games that you want me to try and test out on this build of system. This is just as much your channel, just as much your series, and just as much your build and all this. Because at the end of the day, I'm putting these together to hopefully encourage you to think outside the box and get this kind of setup and way of thinking in your gaming lifestyle. So hopefully that has encouraged you guys to make magic happen. It's been an absolute pleasure bringing this to you. This first episode has been bumper. I've covered so much information. I had to cover so much information for you guys to know exactly what's going on, so you could follow, so you could actually get the relevant information to you. I do make long videos. That's just the way I am, I'm afraid. Hopefully it's all been relevant and pertinent to you guys. So put in the comments down below again if you would like me to feature anything at all. It's been an absolute pleasure as always bringing this to you. All the thanks goes to my Patreon guys. Those are the people who made this possible. The money that comes in from Patreon, I can pump into parts and build systems like this. I can test emulators in different ways. I can build systems and play games and test them for you guys, so the entire gaming community knows what magic can be done when you put a bit of grey matter into it. So thanks again to everybody that supports me on Patreon. There's links if you want to help out in the description down below. Thank you to all the emulator guys, and most of all, thank you to you for actually watching this super bumper length episode. Hopefully it's entertaining you. But as always, please like, please subscribe, ring that bell or whatever it is that people do nowadays. I think you have to ring about 5 bells to actually get notified if I make a video. But as always, most of all, you guys have a good day. Laters!